A very good afternoon to respected dignitaries and one and all present for today's webinar. It is my pleasure to be a moderator for today's webinar. I am architect Snehal Kesarkar. On behalf of AAAAD, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to all of you. We hope you enjoy today's session. Before we begin today's incubation webinar, I would kindly request all the participants to mute your audio and video to have an uninterrupted session. If you have any questions during the presentation, just write them to chat box and we will take them at the end of the session. Thank you for your kind cooperation and attention. Once again, I would like to welcome all the dignitaries, participants, students, and the staff. To begin this program, we are pleased to have Architect Chetan GB, Director at Shunyanava Designs Private Limited, speaker for the day. Today, we are privileged to have an opportunity to listen to him. On behalf of all gathered here, I welcome you, sir.
Thank you.
We are indeed honored to have Professor Architect Uday Gadkari, sir, former President, Council of Architecture, with us as our today's guest of honor. Welcome, sir. I now request our Honorable Principal Dr. K.N. Ganesh Babu, sir, to introduce our today's guest of honor, Professor Architect Uday Gadkari, sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Snehal. Architect Uday Gadkari, sir, former President, Council of Architecture for the term 2012 to 2015. Graduated in architecture in 1981 from Nagpur University, did his master's in city planning in 1984, IIT Kharagpur, academic experience. Sir was a teacher in architecture and planning from lecturer to professor, 32 years, chairman, board of studies in architecture, Nagpur University, member, Board of Studies in Architecture, UG and PG, Mysore University. Member, Academic Council and Senate Member, Nagpur University. Chairman of International Conferences in India. Convener, Secretary of more than 5 national conferences. Keynote speaker in more than 5 national regional conferences. Author of number of papers presented in national regional conferences seminars. Advisor, guide for more than 30 undergraduate, 6 postgraduate and 1 PhD research project in architecture and related projects. Administrative experience. Principal of an engineering and architecture college, 12 years. Director, Dean of Engineering, Architecture and Technology, 3 years. Executive Member, Council of Architecture, India, 9 years. Led Indian Architects Delegation to RIBA, London, UK. Former Secretary of State Association of School of Architecture, MASA. Member, Central Advisory Board on Education, Government of India. Member, Education Advisory Committee, Institute of Town Planners, India. Experience with Council of Architecture. Sir had brought reforms in academic governance of architectural school. Professional experience. Practiced professional projects for number of years and dealt with number of residential, commercial, institutional, sports infrastructure projects. Participated in design competitions. Worked as jury member, examiner for quite a few project competitions. Association with professional bodies. Fellow member in Indian Institute of Architects, life member, Institute of Town Planners, former member, Indian Society for Technical Education, member, Indian Building Congress, member, Quality Control Society, India. Awards. Sir was awarded the Best Teachers Award in Indian Institute of Architects, Nagpur chapter. Sir is also having a wide experience of travel around India and abroad, and his hobbies include writing, reading, storytelling, sports, and cookery. This is a compressed way I can express sir's profile. With this, I would like to invite you, sir, for this evening session.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you.
I would now like to call upon Snehal to introduce the speaker. Over to you, Snehal.
Thank you, sir. Medicine, law, and architecture are the principal professions for the well-being of communities. However, equal inclusion to community does not exist for some people. Architecture can be considered as the fundamental element for inclusion as it creates and shapes the environment that the human beings live in. As architecture is about making everyday lives better for all people. Social responsibility of an architect is what an architecture student has to have a comprehensive idea of. And our today's topic is going to be a guiding source to invoke same sense of responsibility amongst the students. I'm honored to have the privilege to introduce our guest speaker, Architect Chetan GB. He's an eminent architect and interior designer, currently a director at Shunyanava Designs Private Limited. After having worked successfully in two different architecture design firms like Premnath and Associates and Mindspace Architects, he has handled and completed projects in various verticals like institutions, residential, retail, and office spaces. He has pursued BA from Avi College of Engineering, Bangalore, and MArch in Architecture and Urban Design from Syracuse University, New York, USA. He believes in an architecture rooted in life as an integral part of everyday life, a crucial part of the environment and a cultural right, as well as an ongoing process of material life of growth and decay. He believes there are three key elements, the environment, the city, and humanity, are constantly in flux, self-evolving, whilst synchronizing with each other. They combine, collide, and collapse at different times and give rise to unpredictable yet wonderful situations. It is not a fixated idea or preconceived notion, but instead this non-stagnant, complex, symbiotic relationship between the three elements and the synergetic effect thereby which derives our inspiration to create. The result are architecture, which strives to be elegant as well as empathetic, responsible as well as responsive. Once again, I would like to welcome Architect Chetan GB and kindly request you to take over the session, sir.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for this opportunity. Let me just get to the presentation once. Thank you, Sneha. Hello. I'm Architect Chetan from Shunyanava Designs. So the two things that have shaped my interest about what I'm about to talk today are my travel to Medellin from Syracuse University for the research of social urbanism project in Medellin. And one more thing was that every Christmas holidays during my childhood, I would visit my village where my father used to ask me to sit in the village government schools. Two parallel and yet different things, but they have been a huge influence in shaping me up towards an architecture discourse addressing social issues. First, let me come to the social urbanism projects in Medellin. It was my first-hand experience to see how architecture could bring up change. I'll explain this in this presentation. So coming to Medellin. Medellin is a small city, is a city in Colombia. It is in the north part of South America. It is like, this is one of the photographs of old photographs which I found. It is in the 1970s. You can see that there is a huge valley and it is like surrounded by mountains on all the three sides. The city is, as you see, is like grown in that central part. And as the city has grown, it has grown up over the mountains. So like if you have to look at it as how the growth has happened, the center part of it was where robust economic growth has happened. And as they grow up in the above areas where the towards the height up of the Mill Hills, the poorer section of the society have been staying in the top, upmost, because mainly because you don't have a proper infrastructure towards access and accessibility towards these areas. So you can see from this image, like there is this valley, like a river which is running in between. It's called the Ambula Valley. So as there is the city on both sides, there is like these mountains, which is, I mean, where the city of growth has happened on to the, towards the, as they go up. To describe you best for you to Medellin is like, I think all of you have heard of Pablo Escobar, or like, you know, you guys have watched Narcos, in the series where this Colombian drug lord who was been most wanted criminal in the 90s. In the 90s, there was a huge time where there was a lot of deaths because of drug my Medellin cartel, which was taken over the city of like as though they were the kings of the area. But like, you know, there was a constant struggle between the government and the this cartels, where they used to fight for just as like, you know, it used to be a very difficult time for that city. So if you have to compare that, like, you know, see, like, you know, in Medellin, there were 381 homicides for every 100,000 inhabitants. Like if you have to compare it to India, this is like around 160 for every 100,000 for the whole of India. This 381 was like for the only for the city of Medellin. And if you have to compare to the state of Karnataka, this is around 10 presently. So like, you know, this this has been a, like a deep-rooted violence which has been there for like, as you've seen in this series Narcos, or like, you know, if you look at or look up about Pablo Escobar, you'll find that he was one of the most wanted criminals in that at that time. So from that city to have grown from 1991, where there was this 381 inhabitants, I mean the homicides for every 100,000, to get down to 26, it has been like a huge struggle for them, and where architecture has played a huge role in getting that in the this way. How? This is how. Like, see, social problems were like there's this deep social inequality and a historical social debt. There was a deep-rooted violence. So this problem was stated simple and clearly. So what they did was less violence plus social interventions, and then creating increased opportunities, which led to from fear to hope. This formula was like passed on, whereas like this, the Medellin, which is a passionate and diverse city, where there was this huge, what do you call, like cultural influx of people, where this, they were like, for example, this Federico Guitre Zuleiga was was Medellin mayor. He is actually a University of Wisconsin mathematician who came back to Medellin in the 1990s, and then he stood for elections and he became the mayor of Medellin after Pablo Escobar's death. And this transformation was mainly possible because of this mayor. And he instigated this program to be executed. This is my on the right side. You on the right side of my screen is like you see my professor, Mr. Francisco Sanin, who had led us to taken us to this to look at what had happened there, how the transformation had changed the city of Medellin. So coming back to this, as I said earlier, in like if you look at the city as how it is, the central valley where the richest part of the where there's a huge economic growth, and as they grow up the valley, there is like a huge deficit of like, you know, transportation and infrastructure, which leads to poverty driven accommodations up happening up in the up on the upper part of this Medellin. So like if you look at Medellin, there's the central there's a central river and that metro line which runs into this one, and this is where the like all the urban living happens. And more if you go up in the upper area on both sides, you up both sides of the valley, you have this like, you know, poorer section staying up. So What they did was the strategy was planning to improvisation, and then the library prax program and the quality schools program to dignify the barrios. Barrios is nothing but like the municipal wards. Like if you see this here, these are different. There are 15 municipal wards, and they were there in these areas. 15 municipal wards. They were recognized to put these library parks and then quality schools in these areas. Proyectos Urbanos Integrados means it just translates to comprehensive urban projects. PUI, what I will short form, which I'll be wherever I'm saying PUIs, it means mainly comprehensive urban projects against social exclusion and social inequality. So if you see this city, there's the central line which is running. I hope you can see the mouse where I'm running my line, this one. That is the river as well as the metro line which runs. As they go up, cable cars which were infrastructure projects were laid out. You can see from the map where they have done that. So basically, public investments have been focused in urban areas characterized by low human development index and low quality of life index to achieve equality. So intermediate urban plans, special plans, and urban projects. These projects make to the physical components the flagship of the transformation process, integrating cultural and social aspects as well. Management and participation, social management as a means to achieve inter-institutional coordination and communication, community participation. So effective planning, high standard design, accurate construction, and the role of communication and socialization process during the entire process. So public spaces and public buildings as the driving force of urban transformation. Medellin, the most educated, as a political decision. This was the major part of the planning and planning to improvisation was held like these 5-6 points as the driving force for the whole area. So now this is what is the library parks program. So as you see in this photograph, you see the valley which is high up, and you can see the cable car which is running in between. So this is like instead of like, you know, education was given high priority in this one. They identified spaces where there was deep-rooted violence. In those areas, they built up this, so wherever there's a social inequality, these public parks, library parks in these areas. So as you see in this one, the grayer the area, lighter gray the area is the most, poverty-driven, and then deep-rooted violence areas, and then darker gray is actually better comparative. So you see these ones where they have put up these library park locations. So these are the five locations: Santo Domingo, La Ladera, La Quintana, San Javier, and Belen. These five library parks were put in these locations. So this is the Santo Domingo Library Park. This was designed by Giancarlo Mazzanti. As you see in this area, you can see that cable car which is running, and you create a sense of pride in that area where these projects are being set up. So when there's a library park, people have to access this area through these cable cars. So even from the valley area where there is the richer society can be come to access these areas, it creates micro economic zones where the people are selling these sugarcane juices in this public plazas, the tacos, eateries, which creates macroeconomics for them. So this is when they were getting construction. As you see, that's what I was telling. Along with these public, libraries, you have these plazas which are created. And there are, like, if you see in this photograph in the left-hand side, where they put up these small tents around in the plazas, where there's which creates microeconomics for these people in the surrounding areas. And these school children, they have this and it also creates a space for public gatherings for the whole community. So this is Lalatra. It's in Lalatra. This is a library park designed by, again, Giancarlo Mazzanti. As you see those lights in the surrounding city, and then this is the huge. The one thing about Medellin is always this contoured sites where, like, you know, because the city itself is very, have this huge contours around in the, so that was not, that has not stopped them to create these amazing public gathering spaces. This is La Quintana Library Park. Again, this is designed by Ricardo La Rota. As you see in this photograph, as I said, there is this public plazas which have been created, which is used the advantage of the design itself. You know, like, you know, this creates an amphitheater, as you see in the next photograph, where there's this public gatherings which has happened. So it is not just only as a library park, but also these plazas surrounding that library park, which are used for to make sure that people feel welcomed and not just as they are left for themselves. So creating that sense of pride that such things are in there, they're not neglected as a society. So this is again Zanjevier Library Park. This is an architect designed by Javier Vera. Same, like, you know, in all the projects, you can see that language, which is very similar to how give importance to public spaces. So more than the building itself, the surrounding which is happening, the landscape which surrounds it has been created so that they have public plazas where gatherings can happen. So now this Bethlehem library park was there in Belen. It was designed by Hiroshi Naito. See, as I said, I keep repeating myself, but it's the landscape. So wherever there is these, even the surround, more than the building, the surrounding which is used for creating public spaces. So this, again, you have new quality schools program, where the same thing, as I said, they are located in this poorest of neighborhoods. You see, as I said, the whiter the area, the grayer the area, the better the society, the whiter the area, the poorer this one. So that's why you see these locations, if you see in the overall map, the locations of these schools are far mainly in this lighter gray areas. So this is again Antonio Derek Primary School, Secondary School in Santo Domingo. This again is Javier Vera, again architect. As I said, the program, like Santa Rebecca Primary Secondary School in Santo Domingo, Javier. This is the same place. Santo Domingo is the same place where you saw that first black box, the library park in the same area. As you see here in these photographs, where public gatherings were used to, the whole area is used for public gatherings as well as the school children's classrooms as designed in such a way that, like, you know, you encourage gatherings for these. It's not just the school by itself, like, you know, it is used now for the society surrounding those areas. Other than this one, they have improvement plan for 135 existing schools in the which were already existing, but some of them dilapidated, some of them were needed some upgradation. So this is what Josancio, like this is what you can say, like this is an example I've shown here. Josancio Silva School, which was this was a pre-existing school, which this is a photograph, old photograph, and this is what how they had rechanged the overall this one, because maybe one is that, like, you know, it needed a number of people, so they needed to have more number of students, so that's why they have they had to almost dislodge and redo the whole school. Now this coming to this, as I said earlier, one is these schools are done, but then afterwards, what, how does that improve the this one? So they have chosen these wherever these public parks and library parks and the schools were coming, they have, other than that, they have also concentrated on these public plazas, which leads to this schools or this cable car station. So wherever this is happening, anyway, one is that the structurally these areas require like these large column spaces. So and surrounding that cable line, they have put these parks and public plazas. So which is used for this gatherings for the this one. It is not now, before it was very congested and not an accessible space, which even to in both in terms of controlling crime as well as getting people to use these spaces was like very difficult. So they made these landscape programs, which is done here. So the PUIs are located in these slum areas characterized by high levels of violence and social unrest. So PUIs integrate simultaneously all the components of development all together in a well-defined area. That's what I mean about where, you know, the library parks and plazas and the infrastructure, which is the cable car stations. So how they come together to form to these components, which lead to these public plazas. The PUIs are planned and implemented with the active and permanent participation of the local community. So this community, local surrounding community was well kept in integrated towards what was happening. So this is the best example, like, you know, this is the Santo Domingo area where the library park. So as you can see that steepness of that road and this one, how before, like, you know, this where there is a road width of like around 5 meters, where it, we create this open plazas or walkways. So it, even though it's not accessible as a area, the plan of sidewalks and emblematic streets connects this whole city. So Medellin transformation was like a social action altogether. So see this, if you see this photograph, that's what, like, you know, the, even though there is not accessible road, you can see that cable car running on top, and then the walkways which is connecting the cities. In even with the there is one side you have this attached houses right next to each other, and then the other side you have this school which is on the left hand side. So it's like these again, the public plazas with this staircase which is connecting towards so every almost like to making sure that some way or the other you are not left these spaces to be not connected by public walkways or even by this cable car this one. And these housing, like as you see, there was like these congested houses. So when they are removing these areas where they have providing this housing upgrading schemes, which is like, you know, four to five story buildings. This is what you see on the right and left side, are surrounded by these other buildings which is there pre-existing. So other than these library and schools, they also did this Medellin Interactive Museum and Aquarium designed by Alejandro Echeverry. It's also in, but this is in the, like the, where the metro line is there, where the river which flows, it's right at the, in the middle of the city. There's some of the photographs which is there. It's a science museum. This is around the surrounding, on the left hand side you have this science museum, and on the right side you have this botanical garden. This is the botanical garden of Medellin. Again, this is designed by Lorenzo Castro. So this, like this, the metro line which is leads to this. So as I said earlier, so where education and like, you know, providing education was a political goal, but architecture has made sure that, like, you know, you involve the society, as well as keeping in mind that plazas and the spaces which lead to these schools and parks are also become an integral part of the society, which creates one, economic growth, as well as a sense of pride for the surrounding city. So, see, looking at this, looking at India as this one, we had this when we had this during 2008 or 2011, there was this ad which used to come in this one, Lead India Movement. So I'll just play that video, and I will speak about my other project, as well as what was it was a huge inspiration with this visiting site, and then I'll talk about my other projects. So, like, as in that video where you see this kid, school kid with this school uniform trying to move that tree, and trying to take ownership, right? So when you see that, like, you know, it's very true. Like, there are a lot of talented kids in this rural areas, but, you know, as a government, like, you know, if that's what I was telling, that there was two things which have been an inspiration. Like, you know, that's what I said about my travel to Medellin. And the other one is my always, like, you know, my father used to take us to this, my school, his village school, government school, where there was these three classes used to happen in one single classroom, where the first, second, third, one class, means first one row was one class, for one class. In the same classroom, the teacher used to teach simultaneously the three classrooms. So this was like, wholly dependent on infrastructure for a school, you know. So that's what was the driving force for us to think, okay, what is happening in so government sector. So when we started seeing this, we were there is this crisis in Karnataka state. They have now started this program from I think 2004, where there is Karnataka Residential Education Institution Society, where they are making this government residential schools for rural areas, where it is from 5th standard to 12th standard. Education is given free, for along with not just books, food, clothing, and this one. So we saw that and we wanted to get into seeing how we can be part of that response. So we started in Christ. There is Gurukul. I mean, they have along with the schools for boys and girls from 5th standard to 12th standard. The other thing is that even there is government degree colleges, pre-university colleges, which came together in this Chitrali project. We designed this as like, you know, as in a Gurukul, that is this teacher who sits around a banyan tree, and there's kids who are sitting around that in the old Gurukul system, how it was. We thought, envisioned that as a part of this one. So here we had to think of three. One thing is like the architecture involved challenges such as modest budget, time constraints, and even the users with the distinctive needs. This was the reason we tried to drop all our architecture baggage to understand the social and civic aspects that tagged along with the project. This resulted in making a campus that was sustainable and holistic. Every project has a story to tell. The story for the project was to disown the familiar and embrace the unknown. Facilities designed to cater for students belonging to backward castes in rural areas. Hence, the brief given to us was to design a campus with a set of 5 academic institutions co-working and coexisting together, each having its own housing facilities. Since it is to be a self-sustainable campus, it was also to be equipped with the sports facilities and a public space for any events of gatherings held in the surrounding villages and towns. The concept revolves around the ancient Gurukul system, where the students would reside in the campus with their guru. Students would often gather around their guru under the shade of a tree. The layout emulates a banyan tree with a set of concentric circles for each typology of building. The main roads abutting these circles are interconnected with radial walkways at regular intervals to segregate each institution. This resulted in a consolidated, walkable academic campus connecting the academic and the residential quarters. The building placement in each sector is configured in a linear axial system to create an enhanced sense of connectivity. Each sector was one institution, that MTRS schools, Rani Chennamma school, then there is the Pew College, and then the degree college. The innermost circle is a site is divided into 5 sectors. Each one of the 5 institutions that can operate independently. Each phase consists of one of these sectors that house an institution and the interconnecting roads. The auditorium and sporting facilities come in the final phase, acting as ancillary buildings and are shared by all the sectors. We sensitized ourselves to the ecological concerns of the site, where water was very important issue. So all the green areas to be developed in the master plan were to be easily maintainable, Hence, the comprehensive water management system was planned by installing rainwater collection pits, considering that they could be easily found using the existing contours. So finally, like every urban form, the nodes and linkages define the spatial structure of the site. The academic and residential rings and the central open space are the most important nodes, and all the circular and radial roads form the linkages between them. So these, if you see these nodes, like each one is the each node has like, this is the entrance plaza where there's people, where there's the form of a folded hand and like namaste, where that was part of the entry for this one. And then this is the main this auditorium for the overall campus, which was a shared facility between these five institutions. And this is one of the hostel blocks, and then that the other one is the academic block on the on this side, on the left hand side. So this is the overall campus, like, you know, this at site right now, what is going on. Right now, one phase has been finished, and the second phase partly completed. The third phase, which is ongoing at site. So you can see those concentric circles and what we had talked about. And the central plaza open area, which is in the center, which will become the core for public gathering. This is our this is one of the photographs at site right now, where the courtyards, where there's part of the this one and the staircase which leads to the upper floors. And there's this this one is the Karnataka government post-matric hostels. There were like around 53 hostels in the state which were to be designed at, but you know, the sites were all varying different types. One trapezoidal, one like a poly, different sizes, different sites. One were like for 2 acre sites, the other were like on some 80 by 100 site. So this 80 feet by 100 feet site. So that, and some of them are even odd sites. So we had to, we couldn't like, you know, have the time to like, you know, assess each and and make it workable, because one thing is they always wanted something which is easily maintainable and not too much of the cost shouldn't go up. So so the hostels were designed as an independent module with flexible to be repeated at various sites. Massing of a typical module is such that it creates deep niches that allow shading for the windows without the use of chajjas. The design has been standardized to allow expansion while maintaining an efficient and modular design that can be replicated as per future requirements. This type of construction is easy to implement and helps in achieving faster construction. Each room has openings on two sides and shares a common wall consisting of storage space, which becomes an elevation feature on the exterior. The two-room module transform into larger halls to accommodate kitchens and dining areas, or even multipurpose halls. Jali walls allow for cross ventilation in the corridors. All the rooms are designed to accommodate table beds along with the storage spaces, which transform to form the exterior of the building. So you see this, like these are the like different sites. Each, there are around 12 types. Each type was modularized with the same module, what you see in this axiometric view, and repeated in different configurations to form like to accommodate to different sites. So as you see in the bottom, you see these where the site different, that this type 9 was accommodated in 3 different sites. Type 10 was into other 3 different sites. Type 5 had been only in one site. And then this type 12 was like almost like in 15 other sites. So this was done to speed up the process, but also making sure that, like, you know, you have a sense of easy to, I mean, ultimately you get a modularized design. So this is what one of the projects which have been implemented, and you can see the facades and what is this is a hostel at Debur, and this is a hostel at Honali. This is at Kushal Nagar, and then this is HD Kote. So very similar this one modules. You can just like what you see on the. This is one module which has been repeated. This is again Krantivira Sangoli Raina Sainik School in Sangoli, Belgaum. As I don't know if many of you know, Krantivira Sangoli Raina was a general of Rani Chennamma. He fought the British during the 1826. So he was actually he was born on August 15th, and he died on January 26th. He was hanged to death by the British East India Company then. This is his burial ground where he was actually hanged. And this is the smarak where you find this Ashoka pillar there at the site. And there, if I don't know, I think the photograph is not so clear, but like, you know, in that area, there is this people who come with coconut with the coconut and tied to a cloth, where common pregnant women come and tie, hoping that, like, you know, their child which is to be born is like Sangoli Raina. It's a very he's a folklore in the northern Karnataka near Hubli and Dharwad areas. He's very well, see, you, without the internet, he's almost 175 years back. Without internet, without the with the word of mouth, the person has been kept alive in this with the stories told from one person to another. So this was an important, like, you know, project for us, seeing that, like, you know, that the Sainik School is also like for the society as a whole. We are providing to the armed bases. Its Sainik School is actually run by the central government, but the infrastructure is provided by the state government. It was like it works in collaboration. Mainly the principal or the administration division is run by other armed forces. Mainly that means like an air force cadre level, like a brigadier or a general, a brigadier or a captain who comes to resides in the campus, and they for a year they are sent to these different Sainik schools in the country. So it's coming to the school itself, Sangoli is like around it's in a village where he was born. This is around near Hubli. It's around 45 to 50 kilometers away from Hubli. So if you see in Hubli and this one, they're like Dharwad area, you find these Wada houses. Wada houses are like mainly like courtyard houses, which is part of the North Karnataka and Maharashtra residential architecture style, which is even for the palaces in, if you look at they were designed in this format. So we have taken that as part of our design process for the academic blocks, where wadas were designed based on symmetry by the axis passing through the courtyards. The grid, all wadas are built on those grids and according to a square rectangular grid. So if you see this is the design of like one of the wadas, where you see these two courtyards on the left and right side and the center. One becomes a public gathering area and the other is more of a private, and in between space is more like a semi-private area. So in our zoning of the overall design of the campus, we also had kept this like as a, what comes under public, the auditorium, academic block, admin block, they come under the public area. And then the semi-private is like the hostel and the facility centers. And then the residential quarters for teaching and non-teaching come under more of a private space. So in that overall campus design, you have the central axis, which is completely pedestrian, if you see in this one. And then we divided that into public spaces, semi-private spaces and then the private spaces. So even coming to the micro level of that, even there, between three buildings, this is the academic block, this is the academic block, there's the admin block, and then the auditorium building. In between that space, you have the, other side of the space, you have the parade ground, which is connecting the, to the one side you have the statue, and then there is the other side you have the Veera Stambha. In between there is the parade ground, which is more of a public space, and then this becomes a semi-private space where the students gathering happen, like with the amphitheater, which is stepped amphitheater. And then in between those buildings, inside the buildings, you have these small courts which become part of like a more private space for student gathering. So the overall campus like was like in a 100 acres plot with the road running in between, with the 70 acre division on one side and the 30 acre on one side. So the our program was always like to make this 30 acres as a more of a sporting facilities, because the Sainik schools give a lot of importance to sports. So there, once you have the 400 meter track, the indoor stadium, the equestrian grounds, and then hockey and football grounds, and then the shooting range on one side on the 30 in the 30 acres area, and the other this area you have the mainly the academic block and the admin block. This is the hostel block, hostel facility, and then there is the more private spaces with for the teaching and non-teaching quarters. So this is the entry plaza, entrance plaza, where the Veera Stambha is there for like, you know, which is part of the architecture where there always has in temple or in, you know, in a fort, in, you always find the stambas as a part of the integral part of the this one. This is some of the one of the catches where the amphitheater with the academic block with the connecting bridge in between, connecting the this one two academic blocks and the admin block, and then you see the amphitheater. As I was telling you, like the courtyards in the within the academic block, where the entry, where the entrance near the entrance, you have more of a public space, and then they have a private space. One courtyard is used as a public space, the other one as a more private space, for mainly because there is the parents who would be waiting for talking to the staff or anything. They would that is used for that court. So this is like some of the images which you see. As I told you about that court, like, you know, with the staircase which leads to this courtyard. This is actual construction which is actually going on right now. Presently, with this is the connecting bridge and the two academic blocks on either side. As I told you, like, it's more of a like grid pattern, but, you know, we try to break the pattern with this varying facade with with the brick facade. Brick is used mainly for, we have used the brick mainly to give an institutional character. And one thing is, other thing is like, because of like, you know, you have terracotta bricks with has hollow sections, which helps in cutting off heat towards the classroom, inside of the classrooms. And without this makes the facade, the varying facade, interesting. So one thing is that that's what like as the site was there is a like almost like a 10 meter difference between the site on one end to the 30 acres the other side, but in this there was like around 4 meters difference. So we use that to our advantage. One is like to make the public space gatherings with the amphitheater, which you have a seating area further, and then there's a connecting bridge which connects from the first floor of one building to the second floor of another building. Mainly these are a high school and PU block and the middle school in the one side, and the center you have the admin block which is connected by this connecting bridge. As I was telling you about the public space, public and private, this is a semi-private area where that's what used for student gathering. And this is the on-site image of the what's going on at site. This is the admin block. And this is the photograph of the admin block. You can see that curved wall with the brick facade, which is going to be there. And this is the connecting bridge, which connects the two. One is the middle school, the admin in between, and this goes and connects to the high school and PU block. On the right side, you have, on the back side, you have this auditorium building, which is again, that's what, same thing for public gathering. This is again, that's what this photograph, you can see the one is the parade ground in the center. This is a hostel block. This is for the phase two of the academic block. And then backside is the, again for the another hostel block for the phase two. This is the indoor stadium on the backside with the third. This is the road which is cutting across the two buildings. This is the for photograph of the, I mean, sketch for the this one, what we had done in Envision for the auditorium block. We have wanted to keep a similar language for all the buildings. So we have, were using this brick as a material so that like this language carries throughout the campus and the jali wall. One is that it's a very hot place. So brick was used mainly to, as a dowel. One is you have a brick wall and then you have a terracotta brick. So this acts as a the cutoff heat and also this jali walls to create ventilation into the interior courts. Yes, some again some of the photographs. This is the hostel block for again sketch and some of the images is there. This on-site image is what is going on. As I said, again, keeping a language which is similar to the throughout this whole campus. And then this is the residential quarters. Well, we had wanting to do jali wall onto these, onto the other varying facade, but somehow that didn't happen because of the clients, this one. Again, this is the, and the last, you have this B.R. Ambedkar Bhavan in Chitradurga. Chitradurga has this fort. Bhavan mainly, you have mainly Bhavan is used for public gatherings for the town or municipal meetings. So you see in a lot of this rural areas, there's this either in Jagjivan Rao Bhavan or Ambedkar Bhavan, Valmiki Bhavan, are built in the different parts of the Karnataka state. So what they mainly used is for like panchayat meetings or public gatherings for to discuss social problems in the in their village or in their town. So this is one of the projects where in the like the Ambedkar Bhavan was done in Chitradurga district. Mainly if you see Chitradurga, the more it is the fort which you come to first comes is the fort which is very prominent in the, it is visible from the national highway itself. The fort wall, like, you know, if you see, it's like it's done in layers as a, like, you know, peel layers of for this one. So we thought of it as a important, this one, which would you be useful in our, to somehow get that language into our building. So other things is like these murals on these fort walls, the stambas, which is there in that Chitradurga fort. So we wanted to get that into our somewhere, look at it where it can become part of the audio, the Bhavan. I mean, Bhavan is mainly a hall where you have a gathering space for around 400 to 500 people. So this is some of the sketches which we had done. And this is the overall image which is there, which you see that, like, you know, as I was telling you, layered up this one, where there's a hall in behind and then there is a certain office spaces with the you see that, like, you know, that layered walls, like as in a fort you have this. So and then the murals which are put onto the exteriors. Well,
this is my whole team. This is my whole office team. Without them, it's like actually like I miss them as much as I move, as I work here. I will always this it's a product of their whole overall effort, and I'm thank you for this opportunity for letting me speak here today. Hope I have somehow helped you guys, the students especially, thinking you have to think, as Snehal was telling in the beginning, that like you have to think that you are a part of a social, you can bring about a change, then some things can happen. I'm not sure that I have done it, but like keep trying it, whatever you can do.
Thank you, Chetan sir. It was a very informative session. As a student or even as a designer, we tend to get carried away so much, concentrating only on prime areas and ignore surroundings, these public spaces, which can actually turn out to be a heart of the any designs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I would now like to ask you a few questions. How was climatology concerns tackled in the radial design?
That's what, like, if you look at in the scenic school itself, we always wanting to have this courtyard. That's why we are wanting to have this courtyard. That's why the Wada houses were taken as a reference. Because if you see in the houses, that's the court become a part of the overall keeping. One is, yes, for public, private gathering spaces, but other thing is it was keeping the temperatures down. And second one I would say is using the jali walls. And other thing is that I said layered brick wall was a cladding material, yes, to create an institutional character, but also because the terracotta bricks have this hollow sections which reduces the heat transfer from the outside. Because in Belgaum, it's a Hubli and the northern Karnataka, it reaches temperatures reach about to 37, 38 degrees in the summer. So it's quite hot.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I would like to take a next question. Do you think design plays any role to ensure public spaces are safe to either genders? If yes, then how?
One thing is, I say, like, why, if I have to look back in Medellin itself, you have to look back. See, even though if the society as a poorer society also, one thing I noticed was it was very clean. So cleanliness plays a huge role. If you find men who are standing and onto wall, some any wall, and they're without using a loo, it creates a sense of it becomes unsafe and feels not so this one. So you make spaces as a yes, but as how they are used also depends on how as a society we grow. As I said, there is this Swachh Bharat Abhiyan is a good thing. There's nothing wrong. If any government which is doing it is a good thing. It's, you have to accept certain things which is good, and sometimes question something else. That's it.
So what about the cost factor? How can you control the cost? Maintenance part is very difficult in government projects.
Yes, there are. One other thing is, any new kind of material you want to propose, if it is not there in that SR book, it is quite a difficult task, means like, they have to create DR rates. They have something, means you do in three different, you take quotes from three different vendors. Maybe sometimes there will be not three, you will not get three different vendors. So any new type of material, it is a difficult this one. But yes, but what you see is like what we do is like we. That's why if you see, it's not like it's not overtly designed. It's more to see what is available with our budget. You you take that this is my material which I'm going to use and strictly abide by it. You have to control your urges to spend. So I can say.
Yeah. One more question was, how will open spaces design reflect in future, you know, a post-pandemic situation especially? And what are the principles to be remembered?
I have not thought of as yet now, but I think it's a good question. We have to start thinking, you know, whether public spaces will be used like how they are used right now, or like, you know, or will it be necessary at all? But like, you know, if you look at as a society anywhere till now, at least there have been a huge part of, you know, everywhere around the world, if you try wherever we travel, the public places are the where you are taken to, right? Like if I get my from relatives from my village, I would always take them to Kabban Park or a Lal Bagh or this one. And the same way, yeah, if I have to go somewhere to Delhi, I would like to visit Pragati Maidan. I would like to visit the India Gate. But that's what, like, if you, it is part of our culture, you know. But how are we going to change it? Right now I do not have an answer to it.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I would like to invite our guest of honor, Professor Architect Uday Gadkari, sir, to share his valuable insights.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Snehal, first of all, for giving me this chance. Let me first of all congratulate Chetan for the very apt, very informative and pinpointed presentation he gave on the city of Medellin and the consequence of the such certain social issues therein, which called for some very drastic physical interventions, the architectural and urban design interventions. You know, actually, this city of Medellin is known for many things, many good things also. It's the capital of Antioquia, of the Northwest Colombia. It is a city of eternal spring, they say, because the climate is very, very ideal. It's very, it's a temperate climate. And it is also known for the very famous flower festival. Very fertile land, I know, then, and coffee plantation, etc. We know all these other factors also associated with the city of Medellin. But at the same time, there it is also known for the drug trafficking and drug trade, etc., which was the abundance, which was such a this thing that it became a criminal den of the world, you know. And that is why it attracted the total attention of the world. Particularly, we know that it is the Pablo Escobar, famous Don, rather the he was the mafia king, and that it brought lot of social changes, social tensions, violence, then the disparities, and then as he explained the city as such, the center of the city and the city then growing onto the hillocks where the low income group population settled, etc., and which caused lot of social tensions also, and in order to that is, you know, bring them down, in order to pacify them, many physical interventions such as the library parks, then plazas and public spaces, the amphitheaters, neighborhood schools, etc., were introduced. Friends, you know, this is all giving us the idea that the social issues are always of prime importance and concern to all we, the architects and planners, you know, urban designers. For example, basically the very training of architecture we undergo is to gather the information from the various sources. They could be social, political, economical, geographical, geological, climatic, so on and so forth. Then, and then finally, we try to analyze them, put them into proper jargons and see that as to how, what lessons do we learn out of them, which are to be put into the design and planning, whatever we do. And in that case, the social issues, which are of prime importance, have been very nicely touched upon by Chetan. He tried to even show through his various designs, which he has designed and implemented, the concern for the issues which are of very pertinent nature. There could be not social issues every time, which must have guided the design dictates, but at the same time, in every design situation, there demands certain things which are to be very keenly looked into, which have the repercussion, which have the impact, influence over the design, which he tried to show us through his designs. Friends, I have to say something more. As you know, Snehal very rightly touched one question. She said that, Chetan, you have designed beautiful plazas, public places, in the large open congregation spaces. But then now, what will happen after the pandemic is over, after this past pandemic, the post-pandemic, what will be the, will they be used is a big question. Friends, let me tell you, this is a altogether different concern and different parameters now with which we will have to deal hereafter. For all these years, we have had climate change and warming, you know, global warming as the issues. In as far as our country is concerned, we know mass housing, the urban, you know, rural to urban influx, huge exodus, migration, the issues associated with this migration, the city limits expanding, the urban infrastructure of a very poor quality or no infrastructure in vague, and at the vogue or at the or creating new infrastructure. All these issues will have a new look now to give upon, you know, we'll have to see these issues in a different perspective now, particularly after this pandemics. Because the theories was what the economic or social researchers or scientists must have established for all these years. These theories or postulates or models will not come handy in solving this situation, particularly the situation we are going through. The entire world was locked down. The entire world had come to standstill and it was confined within the four walls of the house. And it has caused thousands of changes in the entire working of this globe, you know, world. The world politics is also changing. We know what is happening, amongst the countries. The world politics is changing, and with that, definitely the words like, you know, online exams, online jury, online some webinars, and then conferencing, online conferencing, distancing, social distancing, these issues are not the word, mere words now. They have become very complicated social issues, which will have definitely some impact, some influence on the working of our design this thing, you know, spaces. So it is a very pertinent question, Snehal, you put before. But Chetan, I am very convinced that you have given a justice to your presentation. Very nicely you placed before the audience. We are very happy. As to what will happen hereafter, well, we all are there because it is a transitional space, place. It is all the social systems, economic system, political systems. They keep on changing. There is a transformation, and there is always a solution to this situation. And it is our job to find out reasonable, pragmatic solutions to every such situation. So with this, I conclude, and I thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak. I also saw a large number of participants, you know, who attended this webinar, almost nearly 200 people. I also see many big wigs, you know, Alok Ranjan and this thing, you know, they are there. I say hello to them. I say hello to everyone, your management.
Thank you, sir.
And convey my regards. Thank you so much. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
May I now request our principal, Dr. K.N. Ganesh Babu, sir, to speak a few words?
Thank you, Sneel. Mr. Chetan, I have two observations from your presentation, as rightly expressed by Uday Gadkari sir. The way you presented shows your excellent, experience as a practicing architect and a very good gel with the academics as an academician.
Thank you, sir.
Because, the way you have designed and, documented your project right from, the sketches, the model and also the site photograph, very good documentation, and the way you have expressed, actually gels with the academic part. I highly appreciate your way of expression. That is wonderful. Of course, the project and your the presentation was excellent.
Thank you, sir.
And another thing is, I appreciate, you had finally concluded with showing your team of
they are my
architects. team.
Because, more like a party.
Yeah, because behind every success, there is a huge team working behind. And yes, the credit of course goes, we cannot call upon everyone and recognize, the credit goes to the person who manages. I highly appreciate the way you concluded the presentation. And the beautiful words spoken by Uday Gadkari sir. I thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation and being with us and patiently listening. And fortunately, sir has master's in city planning, a very good gel with your project. I also like to acknowledge the presence of Alok Ranjan, sir, again, planning background, a master's in planner. And sir has been very keen on following up with our sessions. I welcome you, sir. Alok Ranjan, sir, is also having a few words to share in connection with one or two questions which are asked on the post-pandemic. I would like to request Alok Ranjan, sir, to share a few words before we conclude.
Okay, thank you, sir. Actually, I don't want to ask anything, but we are doing some exercise on after COVID-19, what will happen in architecture education and in the practice. You see, in an apartment, people are preferring to have their some mini shop or something, so that the people should not go very far. So like this, we are doing some exercise and we'll let you know afterwards. So thank you very much for giving me the opportunity. And thanks to Kadgari sir for giving such a nice comment. And Chetan ji, very good example of your Mendelian and other things. So thank you very much, the Aditya School. I'm glad. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your wonderful words. So I think with this, I would like to thank all the participants, all the students, the professors, the faculty members, architects who have participated in this session. And please be connected with us every week. With this, I would like to hand over the session to Snehal for a conclusion.
Since all of you have been very encouraging and supporting to us in our AAAD incubation webinar series. As a feast to our participants in month of July, also being the founders month for us, we are lined up with iconic speakers from diverse fields to address our esteemed participants, as we believe in comprehensive learning and development. Also, from July onwards, we'll be issuing certificates along with the signature of our guest of honor. We are sure that this value addition will inspire you more. Coming week, we will have our AAAD incubation webinar series on Friday and Saturday instead of Thursday and Friday. And now it is time to extend my regards to all of you. On behalf of Team AAAD, I would like to express a sincere gratitude to Architect Chetan GB for that inspiring motivational talk. It was very beautifully explained how important public spaces and surroundings play an important role in our societies, and in turn, how important a designer role is. I'm sure the students and all present here will have a lot to take away from the session. Thank you, Professor Architect Uday Gadkari, sir, and Architect Alok Ranjan, sir, and all other dignitaries for your valuable time. We have been fortunate enough to be backed by our beloved principal, Dr. Ganesh Babu sir, management and team IIID for supporting and opening this forum. Thank you, Architect Senthil Kumar, webinar coordinator, and Architect Harshita, broadcasting coordinator. Let me end by thanking all the participants for the active participation. Please stay tuned on coming Friday and Saturday for some exciting sessions. Wish you all a great evening. Stay home, stay safe.